My name is Matthew Vishua. I run the Bible Protector Ministry. It's a ministry about upholding the Word of God, which is true. Today we're talking about believing versus unbelieving theology, and it's about, really, there's a war between truth and error. But this war has influenced many Christians in their thinking, and we'll see this in a moment. So we must begin from the foundation of the Scripture and the leading of the Holy Ghost. That's proper presupposition. Thy word is truth, the Bible says. Every word of God is pure. Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. For what saith the Scripture? These are all quotes from the Bible. Now, there's two sources of knowledge in the world, God or not God. If we begin any inquiry, any investigation, any hypothesizing from any other presupposition but God and his giving of knowledge, it will be foolishness and will ultimately fail. Now, there's three eras of history. There was paganism versus Christianity, and Christianity won. Then there was Roman Catholicism versus Protestantism, and Protestantism won. And now we're in a period or era of modern infidelity versus faith and absolute truth. And you know, at the moment, it seems like that's winning against Christianity. And a lot of Christians, sadly, are taking on board wrong modernistic assumptions in their thinking. Because of the current pervading enlightenment-based thinking, much of Christianity has been compromised. You know, people say, we're going to get on the secular train. Well, that's not leading anywhere good. So what they're doing is they're looking at God's truth from the perspective of human knowledge. And of course, that's going to fail because you're not going to be interpreting correctly the Scripture because you're not starting from a believing point of view, starting from, well, what I know and what I see. That's enlightenment philosophy, rationalism, empiricism. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Psalm 11, verse 3. In Introduction to Biblical Interpretation, a book or a textbook by Klein, Blomberg, and Hubbard, they talk about, and I have a lengthy quote here, they talk about the historical critical method coming from the German scholarship in the 19th century. And they say that it's rationalistic in basis, and they treat the Bible like any other book. They presuppose everything based on natural laws without the possibility of supernatural intervention. They explain away, therefore, miracles based just on their scientific point of view. They have an evolutionary view of time. In other words, early times were primitive. Now, in modern times, men are more advanced, therefore more intelligent, etc. And they look at the Bible merely as a guidebook for morals and not as theologically, true, talking about God and his nature and so on. That's all just sort of a way of explaining. But really, we need to get to just the truth of the Bible, etc. And their truth is a reinterpretation of what the truth actually is. So these presuppositions, these authors say, have brought about decisive shifts in the focus of biblical interpretation. They've got into source criticism, like where did the writings of the Bible come from, since they weren't made by inspiration, or they've just come from various source documents, etc., and source materials, and also in the historical development presumed to underlie the Scripture, where did it come from? It's been changed over time, or it's been influenced from other sources. So Genesis really is just a reworking of Babylonian myth or whatever. That's what it comes down to. And luminaries in this approach, Ernesty, German critic, rationalist, father of the grammatical interpretation, that is that the Bible should be treated like any other book, and Semler, German critic, rationalist, and father of historical context interpretation, like everything can be explained away pretty much. Schleiermacher in 1834 is the father of modern liberal theology, and he founded the grammatical historical school based on those two before of Semler and Ernesty. And of course, this has developed, and even where you've got what you would think are Protestant and you know, people who believe in inspiration of Scripture, various interpreters and theologians who have been tainted from the wrong roots, from the wrong source, with wrong ideas, and also in their thinking influenced with modernistic ideas as well, even though they might say, well, you know, people can say, I believe in 6-day young earth creation. I believe in the flood. I believe in the plagues of Egypt are literal. I believe in the virgin birth, the death and the resurrection and ascension of Christ. And yet, even if they believe in the inspiration of Scripture, and yes, the Bible's true, it's for our doctrine, with the influence of modern theology, of modern thinking, of modern infidelity into their theology, this becomes a real problem, and it begins to corrode their various doctrines and beliefs. And of course, there's all kinds of books on all kinds of subjects in this area. Here's a sample. Talking about the book Biblical Interpretation, they themselves are beholden to previous people who have written about the subject, and if you trace the lineage back, it has the hallmarks and the direct line in ways of the influence of the German critics. Now, to what degree, you might think, well, it's not fully like, obviously these people are believing actually in inspiration of Scripture, maybe. They're not quite the hardened, rationalistic modern critic as other scholars are. But unfortunately, sadly, there is that influence in a lot of modern theology. Modern scholarship is the beneficiary of the underlying unbelieving scholarship it claims to resist. I'm talking about, you know, in Christian Bible colleges today, it's influenced by these wrong sources. And the thinking is corrupted. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. Romans 15, verse 4. We should have the Bible as true today and rely on it, not have this imposition of modern thinking telling us how we don't and we can't interpret it properly. One of the assumptions of the modern theology in coming into proper Christianity is, they'll say, and it's a common belief, perfect understanding is just unattainable. Absolute correct doctrine is just impossible to have. You know, no one's got it right. And proper interpretation is a challenge because of, and these are quotes from that book, Introduction to Biblical Interpretation, in a distance of time, cultural distance, geographical distance, and distance of language. So what about the Holy Ghost? What about God getting his truth to us? No. Just look at Bible transmission and the transmission of the doctrines of Bible through a naturalistic lens. Oh, well, it's just the distance of time and, you know, that's imposing. We can't understand it properly, etc., etc. Another assumption they have is that in interpreting, you should be interpreting the original documents, but, you know, sadly, none of those autographs exist. And this is a quote from the book, and they talk about, however, since none of these exist, the next best choice is to read and interpret the modern critical editions of the Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek texts. These usually reflect the best reconstructions that scholarship has so far produced of what those autographs most likely contained. Now, can anyone see the hypocrisy here, where they came against those German critics for doing this very thing? By the way, this very method comes from German critics. So, oh, well, we've got to interpret properly in a believing way, but when it comes to what you are to interpret, the Scripture itself, just have a naturalistic view of transmission of Scripture. Just have a naturalistic, rationalistic view about how we should be able to get to the best reconstructions based on an empirical view of these other manuscripts available. These ones seem to be dated to the oldest time, therefore must be the most reliable, etc. All of these are just nothing to do with the supernatural agency of God, nothing to do with the work of you know, the Holy Ghost leading us to the truth. No, this is all just natural reasoning, carnal reasoning. Can they not see the hypocrisy of that? Notice the hypocrisy here. They show that it is wrong to interpret in a naturalistic model, but when they approach textual criticism, it is an entirely naturalistic model. In fact, it's a deistic model. Deistic because they say God inspired, but then he sort of just let natural processes occur through transmission. So it's not even a believing method of, there's no scriptural basis for why they're doing what they're doing. It's just natural, man-made, what seems rationally plausible. They also talk about having translation. Is this based on Scripture? Is this based on, you know, what God is showing? No. Their translation method is based on, well, fallible men have translated scripture. Of course, those translations will be fallible. And how are they going to choose among those different translations? Well, it's going to be a fallible choice, isn't it? This is the problem with their approach. Nothing to do with scripture, nothing to do with God having anything to do with translation, nothing to do with God helping us to decide or know what is a correct interpretation, a correct translation, I should say. No, it's all just about their scholarship. And this is the real problem. If you believe in inspiration scripture, if you believe, oh, I believe the Bible, it's not a natural book, it's supernatural, then you've got to also be believing that God has got it through time by transmission and has the ability to let you understand it. And that includes in the area of translation. So the Holy Ghost is leading us into all truth. You don't want to be like these people who now say, well, how to choose a translation for all it's worth. Do you know that's Enlightenment philosophy? That's making everything. It's all subjective, you know. Choose what suits you. You decide truth for yourself. You just choose a translation based on these naturalistic assumptions about what is a best translation. And modern scholarship is continually improving because we're in the evolutionary scheme and therefore we today might be in a better position to better have a better translation that helps us understand a bit more. And of course, usually what they say is you have to have multiple translations so that you could help, the multiple would help you understand, even though those multiple ones may contradict each other in ways and places, that you somehow could draw the truth out of these cacophony of voices. How about the King James Version debate, a plea for realism? Does that sound like starting from scripture or Enlightenment philosophy about realism? How about the King James only controversy, can you trust the modern translations? According to this author, you can trust the modern translations. According to that author, James R. White, apparently the King James Bible is to be maligned in various ways. Oh, well, you know, it's got various textual and translational problems throughout, and its language is hard to understand, out of date, and it's certainly not perfect and right to rely on absolutely. No, he's of course against that, because this modern scholarship is based on Enlightenment philosophy, and those principles of modern infidelity are influencing, even if they do believe in proper doctrines like, as I say, inspiration, creation, miracles, and so on. It's an undermining. Do those arguing against the perfection of the King James Bible start from the scripture, or do they start from empirical data, reason, and human assumptions as influenced by or directly based upon Enlightenment philosophy? Well, sadly, it's leaning towards the latter with these modern versions, modern interpretation, modern translations. You know, when you look at Bible versions and this whole work of textual criticism and so on, those same Bible critics, those German higher critics who were critical, we say critical, that they were viewing the Bible through a naturalistic lens, as you can see listed here, the German ones, they're not coming from a believing foundation. And yet that's what's behind the modern versions and the modern translations. Naturalistic principles such as of Westcott and Hort, and the pervasive influence of modernistic thinking in the modern critical text. You can see people who don't believe even proper doctrines properly, as in foundational doctrines. So can we even know if we have a perfect English Bible, and is it possible for man to make one? Well, what's the answer to that? Let's start from scripture. Bow down thine ear and hear the words of the wise, and apply thine heart unto my knowledge, for it is a pleasant thing if thou keep them within thee. They shall withal be fitted in thy lips. Starting from Proverbs 22, verses 17 and 18. So you go to God. God's saying he wants us to know. That thy trust may be in the Lord, I have made known to thee this day, even to thee. Is God revealed? Is God able to give an answer to this? Can we have a Bible that's reliable? Can we then interpret properly? Can we have proper doctrine? Proverbs 22, verse 19. Have not I written to thee excellent things in counsels and knowledge, that I might make thee know the certainty of the words of truth, that thou mightest answer the words of truth to them that send unto thee. Proverbs 22, verse 20 and 21. You know, the answer is very clear here. We can know the truth. We can know what is the proper text, what is the proper translation, what's proper interpretation, come to proper doctrines. You see, the spirit of error is fighting against the spirit of truth. And the spirit of truth is saying, you can know. There is truth. There is absolute truth. There is proper doctrine. There is the full counsel of God. You can attain to knowledge and wise counsels. What's there instead? A strong delusion sent from God that they should believe a lie. Oh, no, you can't know. No one can know. We're all fallible. We don't know. We're just laboring to get the best possible interpretation we can through naturalistic assumptions about, you know, what happened in the past, reading into the past our biases today. That's what they're doing. For more information about this and related topics, come on to the Bible Protector website. God bless you.